Starting, sir.
Yes.
I am Dr. Rakesh Kumar Jha, final year resident at Army Hospital. Topic of my presentation is vascular laboratory, arteriophysiological assessment, and arterial duplex scanning. Basically, it's a combination of two chapters. Presenting my talk on under following headings, which my topic, then I'll go back to the history background of the physiological monitoring that it is available with us for the monitoring physiological arterial monitoring, basic working principle which is pertaining to them, and then their clinical application. As we all know that the peripheral arterial disease is a growing modality in all over the world. Of the overage world is population, and it leads to cardiovascular, cerebrovascular morbidity and mortality also. So basically, non-invasive tests to confirm and define the extent of vascular disease, especially in patients where we suspect extremity peripheral arterial disease, when the patient comes with intermittent claudication or there is a suspicion on clinical examination. If the patient has risk factors of vascular disease like old age, smoking and diabetes, hypertension, then also we monitor them with the physiological tests. So basically, physiological tests allow the clinician to determine peripheral vascular disease, localize the lesion. It also tells us about the severity of the disease, its progression, and response to therapeutic intervention. So, in a nutshell, surgical testing adds objectivity to subjective clinical evaluation. Information we gather from physiological testing, basically, it's anatomical, anatomic, and functional results. In anatomical consideration, we found point of artery involved, types of lesion, whether there is stenosis or total occlusion, and nowadays it is being used for to determine the morphology of the plaque also. In hemodynamics, we found out the gradient across the lesion, which determines the degree of obstruction. Functional aspect, we find out the severity of impairment, which is caused by peripheral arterial disease, and correlation with the signs and symptoms, whether it's collaborating with the patient condition, signs or symptoms or not. So, what are the indications of physiological testing? It's basically when patient has claudication, exercise-related pain, extremity ulcer or gangrene, which is non-healing. Patient has abnormal ankle brachial ABI or abnormal systolic blood pressure. Patient has trauma or aneurysm. He has if they have pulses, distal cystinosis, limb pain, or at rest. Apart from that, it is to assess the condition where whether the wound is going to heal or not. So primarily, it helps us in diagnosing when the certain like patient having claudication to differentiate it with other conditions like claudication and neurological claudication. It also determines the extent of limitation peripheral arterial disease apart from orthopedic or neurological condition which our patient usually have. Detection of peripheral artery disease in otherwise asymptomatic patient doesn't have any symptoms, has risk factors like old age, history of smoking, and in conditions when they have intermittent arterial obstruction like entrapment syndrome, like popliteal artery entrapment syndrome. In advanced diseases, it also helps us in determining whether the ischemic ulcer will not. It also helps in, it also guides us in finding out the optimal level of amputation and healing of that amputation stump. So going back to the history, first pressure monitoring was done in 1733 by Stephen Hulse. He connected a glass tube to of a mare and determined the systolic blood pressure. And since then, arterial pressure, invasive and non-invasive monitoring started. Boswell invented the mercury manometer in 1820, and after that intermittent blood pressure monitoring was started. 18 stone in the physiological arterial monitoring when Ludwig's developed the chymograph, which breakthrough for obtaining continuous BP monitoring and hemodynamic information. First non-invasive established in 1914 Massachusetts Hospital, and for basic was invented in 1950s. Strandness and co-workers in 1960s developed instrument to detect blood flow and velocity waveform analysis, which progressed to leaps and bounds at the present era. In 1971, Yao correction between correlation between reduction in blood pressure and severity of peripheral arterial. So what all modalities are available with us for physiological arterial monitoring? We have ABPI or ABI, that is ankle pressure index, segmental limb pressure, segmental limb volume plethysmography, TCPO2 like cutaneous oximeter, laser Doppler duplex ultrasound, and invasive direct pressure monitoring system also. Nowadays, we are actually whenever a patient comes to us, we start with a in our institution when we monitor the flow interpretation of the flow rate of the arterial system. Basically, it has got a transmitting piezoelectric testers that converts electrical energy into ultrasound waves, and it hits the RBC moving towards away from the probe, and the resulting wavelength of the ultrasound is being received by the same probe and converted into a oral into a sound energy. Transmitting Doppler is most in between 5 to 10 megahertz, which is suitable for superficial arteries. There is a fluid interface is required between the probe and the skin to prevent loss of energy due to impedance mismatch. As we all know that moving red blood cells act as a reflector that backscatter ultrasound waves, and that sound waves interpreted as in a sound energy. Loudness of the sound received is proportional to the volume of red blood cell moving towards or away from the Doppler signal path. Turbulence due to obstruction or any lesion in the arterial system, then there's a uniform velocity imparts a harsh quality audible Doppler signal, resulting in noisy high-pitched signal, which is also called as a monophasic flow. So basically, whatever oral signals we receive, if there is a experienced clinician, they can interpret it as a triphasic flow, biphasic, or monophasic flow. Triphasic or biphasic flow is a normal flow, triphasic flow in high resistance system, and triphasic to biphasic flow is found in low resistance system also, which shows there is upstroke. During systole, there is hype. There is a reversal of flow during diastole, and there is a forward diastolic flow in late diastole. So these are the basic three phases of the Doppler signal. Dopplers are basically used in measuring ABPI or digital brachial pressure measurement. Profunda popliteal penile brachial index in case of vasculogenic importance, and in very stress tests. Ankle brachial pressure index is the most commonly used physiological for monitoring arterial conditions. It's a basically simple, inexpensive, and reproducible method to confirm peripheral arterial disease. In this, the cuff is placed as in the leg as low as possible above the ankle and inflated and then slowly deflated while the Doppler probe is held over the PTA. Ankle pressure is recorded as the highest pressure at which the Doppler signals returns back. So if we have to measure right lower limb at ABI, there is a pressure in either DP or PTA is a nominator, and higher arm pressure, either of the right or left upper limb, is considered as a denominator. Also used for determination of and determination of and classification of peripheral arterial disease. In norm is between 1 to 1.3, 0.9 to 0.9 is considered, and if it is less than 0.9 is considered as definitive PAD. We have mild, moderate and severe depending on the ABI measured in the lower limb. As we all know that when we measure the slightly higher than the upper limb pressure, it's because when its inherent property is from heart to the leg arteries, to maintain its diameter, it increases its wall thickness, which results in increased pressure and results in higher pressure in the lower limb. Generally 10% above the upper limb pressure. So what are the ankle brachial pressure index? Normally it is taken in the lying down position with patient is at or approximately 10 minutes. If you take ABPI in a standing semi-recommended position without giving adequate rest, or if there is a patient is wheelchair where we cannot take the patient on the bed, then there will be an abnormal reading of ABPA. There may be possibility of faulty cuff application. AHA is the bladder cuff length should be 80% and width should be 40% of the circumference in the extremity. In case of calcified arteries where found in diabetes, chronic kidney disease and calcified vessels, there is a chances of non-compressible and a normal AVPI. When we take AVPI, we take a of upper limb pressure as a denominator. If there is occlusion of subclavian artery in either of upper limb or bilateral upper, then there will be 40 AVPA recording. So what are the role AVPI in peripheral vascular disease? Basically, it is used for screening peripheral arterial disease, in diagnosing, in prognosis and follow-up. Normal ABPI in patient after exercise in a non-diabetic patient has a high negative predictive value, and we can rule out patient with peripheral vascular disease. There is conducted between ABPI and contrast angiography, and studies the sensitivity of ABI was found to be between 79 to 95%, and specificity between 96 to 100%. ABPI also found to have raised in patient with who has cardiac illness or neurological condition. In various studies, we have found that there is inverse relation between cardiac and ABPI. If there is increase, if there is a decrease in ABPI, there is increased chances of cardiovascular, neurovascular, neurological complications. It is also found to be associated with mortality in different studies, and ABI of less than 0.8 is found to have increased in rate of mortality by Pipi et al. In 2011. ABI has some limitations, as we have already mentioned, that accurate in individual with non-compressive vessels, especially in diabetics and patient with CKD. Iliofemoral stenosis occlusion may have occasionally normal AVI at rest. When we monitor their AVI after exercise, we found that normally they have decreased AVI. In these cases where AVI has minimal or no effective role, then we have alternative diagnostic tests available with us, like to break Doppler waveform analysis, exercise AVI test, or duplex ultrasound. So in a nutshell, we found a patient is having peripheral artery disease or not. Whenever a patient comes with a atypical leg symptom, intermittent claudication, wrist pain or non-healing ulcer, we perform a ABI. If it is greater than 1.3, it's abnormal, and we should undertake pulse volume recording or TBI or duplex ultrasonography in those patients. If it turns out to be normal, then patient doesn't have any peripheral artery disease. If it is abnormal, then patient has got peripheral artery disease. If ABI is between 0.9 to 1.3, patient is considered as normal. Considered normal, and it is more than 1.5, then patient is considered 1.3, then patient is considered as abnormal, and then patient undergoes various other modalities of physiological testing. So when do we do a stress test? When it not confirmatory or puts us in more dilemma, then we use a various stress tests like exercise testing or reactive hyperemia for quantitating and functional effect of the disease arterial insufficiency. Basic principle of pressure reduction across stenosis, reduction across exercise testing to detect stenosis not is at rest. Excuse me, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Sir, I'm. So, what are the indications for testing in lower extremities? When there is a extremity arterial segmental limb pressures and PV are normal at rest, and segmental limb pressure and pleural limb pressure is normal at rest, that is even normal point. We first normally, and pressures normal baseline after 10 to 20 minutes of exercise, but peripheral arterial disease. It decreases after a prolonged period of time. Interpretation about the level of occlusion or below. Detection of the systemic level of popliteal. In that condition, it is not ambulant and forbidden. The patient or typical society. Patients of testing when patient. PVT has shortness of breath at rest with minimal infection, like shortness of breath, and patient is able to like amputation. So, alternative features. what treadmill tests are, it's faster and less cumbersome, doesn't depend on patient motivation. It's not affected by cardiovascular or orthopedic condition of the patient. However, it has got low sensitivity and specificity, and it's more operator dependent, as ABI needs to be monitored quite frequently. So second, physiological monitoring, which we do generally, is a segmental leg pressure monitoring, and its role comes when ABI cannot determine the location of proximal arterial lesion, as we monitor the pressure at ankle level. Patient made to lie supine for 20 minutes, then pneumatic cuffs are applied over lower thigh, upper leg, lower leg above the ankle, and sometimes at foot also. Resting ABI is calculated, and then pressure is and then sequential cuffs were inflated in each millimeter of mercury over systolic pressure, and the segmental pressures are determined. A difference of vertical blood pressure gradient between more than 20 millimeters of mercury signifies significant occlusion between those cuffs. And if there is a horizontal gradient, like if you are monitoring both, if there is a difference in pressure between right and left between the same segment, that also signifies the occlusion between those cuffs. The limit segmental leg pressures are it cannot measure the disease distal to, and it doesn't detect disease in non exhalations like profunda femoris artery. However, multiple level diseases like above occlusion above ankle, above femoral and above femoral segment cannot be localized. However, we also can measure the profunda popliteal chordata in a segmental pressure, which tells us about the extent around the knee joint and improvement of patient with profundoplasty in case of lower limb disease. If patient has occlusion of SFA as well as infrapopliteal occlusion, it is calculated by pressures measuring above knee minus below knee pressure and divided by above knee pressure. If it is less than 0.25, there is a possibility of good result following profundoplasty alone, doing any infra-inguinal bypass or angioplasty. But if PP is more than 0.50, there is less likely to get any improvement because by profundoplasty alone. In conditions are not able to in conditions like patient having non-compressing like diabetic and chronic kidney disease, we measure a toe brachial index. Foot arteries are less likely to involve in calcification. Here in this diagram, we can see that toe brachial index or toe pressure monitoring gives us an idea about the severity of peripheral arterial disease. If it is toe pressure is less than 30 millimeters of mercury, there is less likely of healing of an wound. If it is more than 50, there is a high likelihood of chance of healing. That physiological tests are also being used to find out the importance related to vasculogenic conditions. Basically, three penile artery, paired penile arteries are a branch of artery, and among them the cavernosal artery is the most important for erectile dysfunction. If there is a proximal occlusion, like autoiliac occlusion, or there is a variant occlusion. There can be possibility of decreased flow in the penile arteries importance. So using this physiological test, occlusionic importance can be ruled out or can be diagnosed. Penile breaker index between 0.75 to 0.80. If there is a penile breaker index of less than 0.60, it's a diagnostic of occlusionic importance. Next, physiological testing, which is most commonly done, is plethysmography. And principle of plethysmography is the measurement of variation of an extremity in the thigh or ankle during cardiac cycle. There are various types of plethysmography. Market was plethysmography being was the initial plethysmograph being used. Later on, converted to impedance plethysmography, and presently nowadays we are using AF plethysmography, where it's like monitoring of segmental lip pressure. There are multiple cuffs are tied in the lower lip, and it's that cuffs are inflated with the air, and the pressure changes in the limb, pressure and volume change in the limb is monitored during cardiac cycle by this method. Normally, in pulse volume recording, which has got a upstroke, a diatonic notch, and a downslope. It's a normal PVR recording. If there is a change in if in case of patient with peripheral arterial disease, there is a loss of dichrotic. There is a loss of contour as well as becomes more flattened. So waveform changes in PVR pattern. Early loss, first and foremost, is the loss of dichrotic, followed by there is increase in upstroke time, widening of the peak. There is a loss of amplitude. These are the various forms, various forms of PVR, which is monitored in normal, mildly abnormal, or severely abnormal peripheral arterial disease. It can be measured accurately in patients with non-compressible vessels. Useful as a diagnostic test for patients with suspected peripheral arterial disease, and this is limb revascularization. It also predicts limb ischemia and foot arthritis for diagnostic of PVR in monitoring detecting peripheral arterial disease as up to 97%. When we compare with the PVR with Doppler, it also has got pulse detection and waveform detection. PVR is a more reproducible than Doppler, and presence or absence of edema has no role in monitoring of PVR. In contrast, if there is physiological variations such as vasoconstriction, vasodilation, or directly influence pulse amplitude in case of PVR monitoring. In case of if you want to monitor the pedal or rule out the pedal arch occlusive disease, digital plethysmograph, which and flow rate in the pedal arch. Digital for determining the extent of sympathetic activity in patient with cold sensitivity and Still syndrome, dialysis access graft is being used. Digital has got measured with response techniques. A technique of it is a cuff is placed at the ankle, inflated over systolic pressure for minutes, and rapidly deflated while the digital PVR is monitored. Normal limb turns to normal and it attains half of its baseline amplitude within a few. While it also about the response to sympathetectomy. When the PVR amplitude less than twice the resting level after reactive hyperemia, it sympathetically and likely to improve the skin blood flow. Physiological monitoring is transcutaneous oxygen tension monitoring, which state of the lower limb. Principle is that the electrodes containing chloride anode surrounding a central peritoneal cathode are placed at dorsal of the foot, anterolateral aspect of the calf, 10 cm below patella and 10 cm above the patella. And the subclavicular region anode is used as a reference site. The electrode is heated for up to 45 degrees centigrade, which causes vasodilatation and diffusion of oxygen from the capillaries. This oxygen was measured by the transcutaneous oxygen tension and helps us to find out the peripheral artery disease. If it is more than 50 millimeters of mercury, then as normal. If it is between 20 to 40 millimeters of mercury, wound healing is unlikely to be, is not reliable. But if it is less than 20 millimeters of mercury, it is unlikely. TCPO2 is used in classification of peripheral artery friction, serial assessment of peri-wound oxygenation, prediction in optimal level of amputation, and also selection of patient for hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Few factors affects the measurement of transcutaneous oximetry, like raised skin temperature, body cellulitis, hyperkeratosis, increased metabolic and increased venous pressure. The important consideration about transcutaneous oximetry is that decreases skin TCPO2 because of shunting of blood or skin to the muscles, but it is not affected by arterial calcification patient with diabetes and chronic kidney disease. TCPO2 is mild to moderate degree of peripheral arterial disease because the oxygen supplied to the skin is far and oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve does not change significantly until oxygen saturation drops to less than 8. The less used physiological performed for peripheral arterial occlusion is less color and skin perfusion pressure, which it uses monochromatic light motion of red blood cells at the depth of approximately 1 to 1.5 millimeter in the skin. Normal pressure monitored by this is 50 to 70 millimeters of mercury. If it is less than 30 millimeters, then it predicts, classifies as a critical limb ischemia. Non-invasive vascular studies in combinations are used in like interpretation diabetic foot for wound healing or other conditions. It also like ABI, toe breaker index, PVR, TCPO, all are used to classify the peripheral arterial disease. It is used nowadays as for wound healing in Wi-Fi classification. Ankle breaker index, ankle pressure and toe pressures, various toe pressures are used to determine whether wound heal or not. Less commonly used physiological near infrared spectroscopy, where laser light source are used is produced by a photodetector and received by the same probe. It basically determines the tissue oxygenation of the muscles in the lower. Capillaroscopy is being used for like needle bed capillaries, and it determines peripheral involving the small vessels. apart from all these non-invasive testing, direct pressure monitoring is also being done during angiography or angioplasty, which is a goal. When these tests are being done, when there is physiological tests are inconclusive. Whether in such conditions where there is a doubt of patient having peripheral artery showing actual result, then vasodilators can be used. Artery CFA is punctured and 18 gauge needle and connected to a standard stent stiff tubing, and the same pressure and the same tubing is used to measure the in the radial artery to avoid any defense because of height or tubing conditions. Coming to the second part of my presentation, that is arterial duplex scanning, introduced by Estrandes in 1974. It combines dimensional grayscale ultrasound imaging with velocity measurement and provides anatomical as well as hemodynamic. Principle of duplex ultrasound is it converts the electrical energy to sound energy, and the same device transmit and receive the signal and convert it into the interpretable sources. Ultrasound beam, returned ultrasound beams, the transducer array converted organized both pixels to yield a two-dimensional view of the tissue beam scan. High linear probe is used for superficial arteries, or smaller frequencies collinear probe is used for visceral. So types of Doppler ultrasound: brightness mode, B mode ultrasound, color Doppler, and power Doppler. Sound is B mode ultrasound basically defines the anatomical landmark of the arteries. It shows about the wall condition, intraluminal condition, and compression outside. It of arterial narrowing. It determines aneurysmal true and false. It calcification, graft abnormalities, and plaque morphology. It is in determination of carotid intimal medial thickness, which is used for the carotid disease. In color Doppler, B mode ultrasound is superimposed with the color, and it's also determining the flow direction and mean velocity. In healthy individuals, arterial flow is pulsatile and laminar, but in case of peripheral arterial disease, there is a spectral broadening, or there is a broadening, or there is a biphasic flow is lost, and that forms a biphasic or monophasic flow. As it was discussed earlier, also the Doppler ultrasound has got three condition: upstroke, down upstroke in systolic condition. In early diastole, there is a downstroke, and there is again third stroke in late diastole. In case of peripheral artery disease, it becomes either monophasic. The TARDIS, the Doppler ultrasound is seen in arterial stenosis. Phenomenon is observed distal to the site of stenosis. TARDIS pattern is basically long systolic acceleration and slow upstroke, and Parvus pattern is considered as when systolic amplitude and the rounding off of systolic peak. Power Doppler is based on amplitude of the returning ultrasound wave. It is key of flow detection 3 to 5 times better than the color Doppler. Of power Doppler is that it is independent from the angle of insonation. There is an absence of aliasing and the ability to detect very low flow rates by the Doppler. Apart from that, we have got spectral Doppler waveforms. In a Doppler ultrasound, cases which provides us and guides us about the peripheral arterial diseases and severity of disease. If it is a peak systolic volume in a Doppler waveform is a basically corresponds to small peak in the spectral waveform, and the PSV ratio before stenosis that is considered as VR is determines the severity of stenosis. If it is two, there is a possibility of more than 50% stenosis, and if it is more than correlates with the correlation more than 70% stenosis. Other indices which is being used in Doppler ultrasound is pulsatility index, peak systolic velocity minus minimal diastolic means velocity. If normal is normal peripheral arteries more than 4, less than 4, it determines the occlusive disease. It is measured in basically low resistance arc. It's calculated by subtracting PSV from end diastolic velocity divided by PSV. Normal value is less than 0.5, and if it is more than 0.85, it represents resistance and decrease in end period. Systolic acceleration time when it reaches from baseline to the peak is also a marker of or stenosis. If it is less than 1.133 milliseconds, it's normal. If it is more than that, then it's considered as abnormal. Acceleration time is influenced by the cardiac conditions like cardiomyopathy and aortic valve disease also. So various spectral waveform parameters, which are different arterial beds, are as follows. In carotid, the PSV, end diastolic volume, the systolic index, acceleration time, and presenting duplex, normally we use all of them except mean flow velocity. Main use of arterial duplex scan is screening of for arterial disease. It enhances accuracy. Intraoperative assessment is also being done when having flow obstruction or completion procedure. Surveillance after arterial intervention, either bypass, either allogenic or autogenic bypass, and evaluation of plaque. Peripheral arterial disease, peak systolic volume, or helps in determining the level of occlusion also. Normal condition, peak PSV is normally less than 150 and velocity ratio is less than 1.5 and spectral waveform shows triphasic pattern. But if there is a peak systolic velocity of more than 4 and velocity ratio is more than 4 and patient has the monophagic flow in Doppler ultrasound, then stenosis is more likely up to 75% or more. Doppler ultrasound is also used in classification as well as to determine the percentage of carotid artery seen in this chart. If the patient has got ICAP less than 125, there is a likely chance of occlusion less than 50%. If it is more than 230, then there is chances of more than 70% arterial occlusion. Renal artery stenosis is also renal artery. The percentage of stenosis is also being measured by the Doppler ultrasound by aortic ratio, which is determined by PSV in renal artery and suprarenal aorta. If it is around 80 plus minus 20 centimeter per second, it is considered normal. If it is less than 3.5, then also is confirmed normal. But in case of form, that resistive index is less than 0.8. also helps in determination to define the occlusion in the mesenteric vessels, determining the PSV in various mesenteric artery. So Doppler ultrasound is endolic. It determines endotension, thrombosis of false lumen, intimate hyperplasia, graft infection, AV, and that assessment of failing. It also helps in surveillance of the bypass or if there is a logistic bypass. It normally, Doppler ultrasound is done after 30 days, 6 months, or annually thereafter, placement of any vein graft. If it is more than 300 PSV more than per second, or if there is a pellucidity ratio of more than 2, or there is a decrease in ABR more than 0.15, it tells us an indication for doing any further intervention. The systematic review of the literature for three different modalities in percentage of stenosis, and they found that Doppler ultrasound is equivocal in determining the peripheral artery. Advantage of Doppler ultrasound is easily available. Contrast is used, no ionizing radiation is being used, effective and suitable for serial examination. However, the disadvantage is that shadowing from overlying vessel calcification, inaccuracy due to aliasing, and there is a chance of gender and physiological condition which differentiate differences in the values. And most commonly that operate, which can lead to the improper assessment of the arterial system. Special types of Doppler ultrasound, apart from normal routine ultrasound, which uses 2 to 5 megahertz pulse range detected Doppler device. There are 4 approaches for translinear Doppler. It's a trans-temporal, which we normally use carotid interventions, transorbital, transoccipital, or submandibular. In transcranial Doppler monitoring, we detect cerebral arterial, it helps in detecting cerebral arterial stenosis, and it measures hits high during carotid interventions like carotid angiography, angioplasty, and endarterectomy. Ultrasonographic virtual to find out the plaque morphology. As we all know that when ultrasound being released, the different tissues reflects different waveforms of the ultrasound, like echogenicity of key components of ultrasonic plate, like calcium, fibromuscular tissue, and NRC and IPH gives different wavelength, the return ultrasonography. This returned wavelength is processed and helps in determining the plaque morphology. Three-dimensional ultrasound is basically used to find out the various anatomical landmarks, and it reduces the operator variability inherent in the imaging. However, the disadvantage is it has got a slow frame rate, spatial resolution, and has got a lengthy analysis time. Ultrasound, which is nowadays being used as contrast enhanced ultrasound, is that the perfluorocarbon or nitrogen gas is injected intravenously, which has got an external shell tightly composed of albumin galactose. It's basically forms a sustainable gaseous to the arterial system, which reflects the ultrasound waves, and the ultrasound wave is being interpreted conditions. So it has got carotid occlusive disease like determination of plaque morphology. It helps in determining the neovascularization. And in abdominal aortic aneurysm, it helps in determination of ruptured aortic aneurysm or retroperitoneal hematoma. It also helps in determining endolysis. In peripheral arterial disease, it helps in determining the muscle function in lower extremities. It has got a therapeutic role also by direct drug delivery into the arterial wall, thrombus resolution. Last of all, the ultrasound has emerged as an important adjunctive modality of angiography. It gives us a real-time 360-degree vessel anatomy and morphology, and its uses is basically in precise imaging of the vessel size and plaque morphology, guides intervention procedure sizing, and detects interluminal waves, mass lesion, residual thrombus, compression as well. So, take-home message is that peripheral arterial disease affects worldwide and associated with significant cardiac, renal, and neurological morbidity. Early arterial disease not only allows treatment but also helps in risk factor modification associated with it. Non-invasive physiological modalities are important tools in management and follow-up of peripheral arterial disease patients. However, none of them are ideal in isolation. So, when interpreted in conjunction, provides a better. Thank you.